Okay, so I guess let's start. Good morning, excellencies. I see on the left side. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning, dear colleagues, and I would add also friends. The book presentation, actually two book presentations today we have, and it's always a very pleasant event to come out at the beginning of the year with some product, with some good, with some result of also the previous year's work, and to start here with a publication, or publications actually in this time. This is a year which started, of course, with our EU presidency. It started with also tragic events in Paris and terrorist attacks, and also reminded ourselves how fragile and how vulnerable and how interconnected the open world is and what kind of challenges we face. So it also shows and reminds us that Latvian foreign policy this year faces quite a number of opportunities, be it in the context of EU presidency, but at the same time we face our challenges as well in a fragile, in a world which has a full of not always pleasant events as well. But at the same time, beginning of the year, it's not just about the EU presidency this year, but it's about annual debate on foreign policy. So every year we engage in debate, in exchange of thoughts, how our foreign and security policy should look like. And in the recent years, in a few already, a couple of years, there is a foreign ministry report, there are the parliamentary debates in the parliament in Saeima, and also the think tank sector, think tank segment is willing to contribute to the debate, and that's why we are happy to present those two books. If you define what we have seen in the last years about Latvian foreign policy, how it looks like, that I would say that it becomes increasingly professional. It becomes, I guess, I would like to say, increasingly proactive as well. Proactive in the world when looking for new formats, new dimensions, new vectors of foreign policy, as well as a new emphasis in foreign policy. And I think it's a very good development. Actually, to stay the same, as some would say, you have to look for the new things. You have to be proactive. And of course, it is demanded by the international environment. International environment is challenging, and we cannot ignore it. And we have to adjust to international environment, and we have to look for our own opportunities. But I think it also reflects, I would hope so, it reflects the increasing capacity of our foreign and security policy decision-making establishment, and capacity of the foreign and security decision-making establishment and structures and institutions, and also NGOs related to this sector. And also the Latvian Institute of International Affairs is, I think, part of this trend, and in the recent years we also started to more actively engage in public debate. Last year we published the first, you can say, pilot project on the Latvian foreign policy, the foreign policy yearbook 2014. So this year we come with a new one. And additionally to this, there is also the book on economic diplomacy, which we believe is one of the important segments of this proactive Latvian foreign policy as well. But last but not least, and I will be happy just in a second to give floor to Werner Rechmann from Friedrich Ebert Stiftung. Last but not least, it's very important that in this engagement, in this exchange of thoughts, in this proactiveness of ideas and proactiveness of activities, we have a very solid and increasingly productive partnerships. And this is what I absolutely must underline about our partnership with Friedrich Ebert Stiftung. Friedrich Ebert Stiftung has been always, when it matters, to be present. Conceptually, yes, it was in a couple of years ago when we, you can say, restarted our activities as an institute in a sort of making all qualitative important steps. Friedrich Ebert Stiftung was present and supporting us, and we are very, very highly appreciative. And I would always say that we are happy and lucky to have such a partnership. So, Werner, the floor is yours, and once more, thank you for also contributing, because it's not just about the decision makers, it's not about public opinion makers, but it's also about foundations such as yours, which is absolutely contributing to the enriched and quality debate here in Latvia. Werner, the floor is yours, and thank you.
Thank you very much, Andris. First of all, excellencies, ladies and gentlemen and friends, welcome to these two book launches. And on our side as the Friedrich Ebert Foundation, it's a pleasure but also an honor to work very closely together with the Institute. And at this stage, I would like to thank all of members of the Institute, especially Andris, Kārlis and Diāna and the whole team for our kind of cooperation. And as you know, the Friedrich Ebert Foundation is a German political foundation related to the Social Democratic Party. And we were founded in 1925 when Friedrich Ebert, the first elected democratic president of Germany, in the first democratic Germany, passed away, and that was his last will to found a foundation. And we are very keen, especially these days, with the Minister of Foreign Affairs, Frank-Walter Steinmeier, a social democrat, to work together in this foreign affairs field, and especially within the European Union. But as Andris mentioned already, in the present crisis, which is really a concentration of crisis, it is really a challenge for Latvia then to have the EU presidency. And it's not only Russia, the Ukraine and Crimea, also internationally, and Andris mentioned it already, is the dramatic situation and what happened in Paris, but also within the Arab world. So, the foreign affairs issues are more than just like diplomats talking to each other. And Willy Brandt mentioned once, foreign affairs is too important to leave it only to diplomats. It is also for researchers, for other people, and also, of course, for the civil society. They should be involved, and you see it within the European Union. When the civil society, in the broadest sense, is not involved, then you create resentment against the European Union. And in the last European elections, quite a number of people voted for parties who are against the European Union. And I think there, all of us, not only diplomats, but of course diplomats are the front runner there, should work in this issue. The second one, economic diplomacy. In my opinion, being responsible for all the three Baltic states, I think there is quite a lot of space for the three Baltic states to work more closely together in economic areas, in infrastructure. And it's my impression, the crisis with Russia and the pressure from the Russian side brings the three Baltic states more closely together. And I think that is out of the crisis, which is a disaster, but is a good sign for the work together, not within the Baltic states, but also Baltic Sea countries and the Nordic countries. So finally, because we are short of time, I would like to thank again all members of the Institute, and it's a pleasure for us to work together with them, and we will continue this relationship. Thank you very much.
Okay, so thank you once more, Werner, for support and contribution. And I must add that not always we agree with each other, but I think this is a part of the very pleasant engagement and exchange of thoughts. And as well, of course, we are thankful to the authors of the publication and both publications. So, and I can see a number of authors here also in the room. So, if there be some particular questions, and I will identify that there is somebody who wrote exactly a particular chapter and particular aspect, I would be happy to sort of to give the floor to the particular author as well. But thanks to them, these publications also came out, and especially Latvian Foreign and Security Policy, which was very much on voluntarily basis as well. And here, I guess, come back with some of the things, and I would not like to monopolize the floor But still, some of the things I think I would still say in the beginning also, what kind of conclusions we draw, even though I should immediately make a disclaimer that there has been a diversity of views, and not all those views, what just I will now, in a sense, summarize in a very sort of the big box, are sort of reflection of all the nuances and details and particular emphases which were also emphasized by particular authors. But anyway, so a couple of things looking back and looking forward. Looking back, about reflection of 2014, what it meant for Latvia's international stance and diplomacy. And here again, sort of as I say, there will be my subjective emphasis from my side. First one, I would say that actually Latvia, the 2014, despite all the insecurity, all the challenges to the regional stability, there have been some positive developments for Latvian international stance. Paradoxically, but I would add that Latvia became finally, in 2014, a full-fledged member of the NATO. Just in 2014, after we, 10 years after we joined NATO, basically in 10 years later, we became a NATO member, full-fledged member. And also now we are becoming, you can say, the full-fledged member of EU by leading the EU presidency. Why we became a full-fledged member, I think that at least how we would perceive that we've been externally perceived, that finally this is the region which is important to defend, which is important to protect, but also internally. I think that there is a perception that we are perceived in this way, that we are like-minded, and that also we are having responsibilities, important responsibilities, to strengthen these perceptions, also externally, how we are being perceived. You can add to this that in 2014, before we usually spoke about the trend that US pivoting to Asia, I think in 2014, to some extent, NATO and US pivoting to North. Again, so these are the paradoxes, but quite a favorable paradoxes for us. But it must be remembered that all this, these positive developments, us becoming a full-fledged members of the NATO and EU, that finally we are being perceived as absolutely equal, at least it's our perception, that happened in a very unfavorable international environment. We speak about Russia's aggression, we speak about destabilization of the region, we speak about increasing structural weaknesses of the EU, we speak about absolutely what Werner mentioned, the rising populism wave in the EU, and we will see these challenges increasingly also in 2015. We see also differences among the region countries. We usually said that new members, the EU new members, that Central and East European countries are similar in their opinions. You can say they are not. With regard to Russia, there is absolutely clear division. Three Baltic countries, Poland, to some extent also Romania on one side, and then you see Slovakia, Czech Republic and Hungary, quite a different stances. So you see that it's not so simple to establish these regional Visegrad-Baltic connections and common stances. So yes, there are paradoxically good developments for Latvia, but at the same time in a certainly unfavorable circumstances and environment. What Latvia proved in 2014, that there are strengths of Latvia in general as society and strengths of Latvia as also foreign policy player. I think the societal maturity, elections, ability of diplomatic service, mobilization of political and institutional elite, also ability to make important decisions. And here I first of all refer to the 2% of a decision on 2%, what we are willing to devote to the defense expenses by 2020. Also the proactiveness. Once more, I would like to underline proactiveness, the new directions, Central Asia, new sectors, economic diplomacy, some of that transportation diplomacy. Last year we had a big conference as well. So I think this proactiveness is here and we can really value that we as a society develop. And as Zbigniew Brzezinski is saying, foreign policy is not anymore about foreign policy. Foreign policy, it is about societal performance, how society performs, how powerful and consolidated it is. So this is actually the model what you reflect is the most important, especially for a small country. And I think we show the strengths of societal development, societal ability to react. At the same time, I cannot ignore, and I cannot avoid saying that also it showed vulnerabilities of Latvian society. And we can speak about ability. Actually, I mentioned the ability to mobilize society in important times. It was a strength, but same time there are some questions. How united we were during the Ukrainian crisis or Russia's aggression. And there have been differences among different political institutions, and I think we can criticize some of the elements here. Not always everything looked in a harmony and streamlined and in a common, on a common page. So this is not always that everything has been perfect. Also, still we remain with divided society. It is still one of the challenges. There are some positive trends, absolutely. But at the same time, let's not forget that there are also still challenges that how we developed in the future, how consolidated we are, also the shows how powerful and strong we are in our foreign policy. As some would say, diplomacy, foreign policy, security policy, first of all, starts at home, not externally. Also, corruption is still remaining, and which is, in a sense, cancer of society, within society as well, and we cannot ignore it either. So I mentioned 2% for defense expenses, excellent, but same time 2% would not solve the societal challenges, which are quite a deep ones. What are the 2015 major challenges and opportunities? I will not go into the detail because I think I need to pass the floor to my colleagues, but of course Latvian EU presidency, it already started basically in September 2014, as some would say, so we are fully, it's not just in January, but they're fully in the presidency mood. I think the important element is, again, sort of what's going on within Europe. It's not just about traditional challenges to Europe, but it's about the hybrid challenges, it's about the terror challenges. So we might define that we live in a world of geopolitics of religion and resentment as well. And resentment also not just outside the EU, but also within EU. So the populist parties are here. In all this, we are willing to develop the new security strategy, and the EU, Latvian EU presidency is also there. I think we'll be trying to give the push to this. But at the same time, it's not just about strategy with regard to our partners outside the EU, but first of all, actually, it's about strategy consensus building within the EU among the 28 countries. And it's not a simple simple process because we so much differ among ourselves. So for Latvia, Latvia's challenge, it's always, as I underline, it's not how the presidency starts. When the presidency started, immediately media called. I think it's much more important how the presidency ends and what is one day after the presidency, how it's being continued, what we invested during the presidency. And so presidency is an investment and in a process where our institutions must be strengthened, but also partnerships established, and sort of this proactiveness must be continued also the immediately after the presidency. I think it's much more important how we value success of the presidency. Security partnerships in this are important. Of course, NATO is important and TTIP is important, and so-called, I mentioned transportation diplomacy, we can speak defense diplomacy at home and externally, avoid free riding, but same time also avoid reckless riding, as was mentioned by some of the authors in our publications. Yeah, so of course, to engage in a dialogue with our neighbors, it is important. And here the Russia comes to our mind. We've been quite successful in expressing our opinions, in escalating, let us say, sanctions, but I think it will be quite a challenging how to de-escalate and also the how, if it's necessary, also further escalation of the conflict if the circumstances require this. I can immediately add that majority of authors were quite strict on Russia, how we should continue our relations with Russia as a dialogue, yes, but at the same time, cursive diplomacy is a very important tool to coerce Russia into the, in a sense, more favorable behavior as well. So no military cooperation, strict non-recognition of annexation of Crimea, and of course, moving forward with Eastern Partnership. In all of this, regional stability is important, and Diāna will elaborate on this more, on Eastern Partnership. I think information and strategic communication is very important. We are now fighting not just, you can say, for some kind of land and territory, but for minds and hearts of people, first of all. And once more, coming back to the weaknesses and strengths of society and our foreign and security policy, it's first of all about the minds and hearts of the people, how we perceive, how they perceive what it is good and what it's bad, and how we are successful, how successful we are in implementing our priorities of state as such. So 2% for defense is important. It's in a sense solidarity investment, but I would say it would be good to look for some 2% for a more smarter and equal society as well would be important. Yeah. So we are very much focused on defense expenses, but what about education? What about smarter society? What about equal society? So foreign policy starts at home. That has been mentioned also in a, some of the publications that we should be careful of electing little green president. Well, namely, once more, underlining that there are some weaknesses, even though here I think we might differ, but basically I am personally in favor and popularly generally elected president, but I mean it once more, it's just a small thing in a wider discussion. What is immune system? What we should do to build a more powerful and strong society. Last but not least, I would like to underline, I think, which has been, in a sense, not fully developed the potential that think tank community must be involved more and more, you can say, also supported by the institutions, because sometimes it seems that institutions are just monopolizing, doing their own, you can say, activities without being willing to engage too actively with also the hubs and centers of thinking and ideas. So I think actually if we add to strategic communication, diplomacy or intellectual diplomacy or expertise export also is important part, not just of within a country, but also externally. And here I stop, you can say, giving the general overview and some of the ideas what I believed are important. And I understand that they are also a little bit fragmentary because we cannot go through everything. And I hope we'll be able still to more go in detail during the Q&A session. But here, speaking of export of some products, and I mentioned export of intellectual expertise, strategic communication, intellectual diplomacy. Still, we come back also that we need to export our goods and commodities, and we have to implement our economic diplomacy. And in this part, I'm happy to give floor to Kārlis, who was co-editor, and I would say the major co-editor of the economic diplomacy publication. Please, Kārlis, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Andris. Well, your general remarks actually cover two-thirds of the points which I wanted to make. But anyhow, I think before addressing the book, and I think I should concentrate on this book because it's actually an essential achievement. The original idea was incepted a very long time ago already by Andris mostly, and then I joined the project, and then got Spelnats joined the project, and this was the idea that one should evaluate finally what and how our economic diplomacy is working. Long time ago, together with the Eastern Policy Research Center, we also published a research on Russian and Belarusian economic presence in the Baltic states. But we wanted to expand this. We wanted to concentrate more on the actors. Who are the actors in two dimensions: Western dimension and Eastern dimension. But before I go into the book, a couple of remarks going back to what Andris was saying, and I think the 2014 and 2015 have been quite a watershed moments in European recent history, in Russia's recent history, in the Baltic recent history, and this of course is the moment when mobilization of resources, and then mobilization of society as how we perceive it, has been taking place. More than it has been taking place in the last 20, or well, basically since the regaining of independence of the Baltic states. So in this case, I think when Andris was talking about the region, that this is now finally the region to defend. Of course, the question remains, and I'm going to be a little bit critical on many issues. in this introduction, because I think it's from the outside, the region. Now the perception from the outside is that this is a region to defend. The question is, and still remains, is this really a region? Is this the country to defend from the inside? Do the people living in this country actually perceive this country and this system, this state, as the one to defend from outside influences? There are societal challenges, as Andris was mentioning, and this is the major problem, is about the minds and hearts of the people. The question about the narrative. Do we have a national narrative? One thing is drafting a preamble, which states quite a lot of important things, of course, but the very other thing is, do people really believe in it? Do people really have read the preamble in the first place? And do they understand what is meant by this? This is the general. I have had many conversations with different experts from outside throughout the 2014, and they were talking about two narratives, having two narratives. The question is, do we really have two narratives? Do we have even a one narrative? And in this case, if we have, do we all share it, and what it is? And this is the thing which we should be concentrating on in 2015, in 2016, absolutely. And the other thing, of course, again, minds and hearts of the people, it's about the security. It's about security, but one of the things which is sometimes forgotten about security is the economic security dimension. The question is, do people feel satisfied with the economic situation that they are in? The very fact that Latvia still has 67% of the average of the GDP per capita of the average of the European Union, and that the minimum wage is around 250 euros, which still influences in many regards how people compare this society with another society, their belongingness to this society, and how they perceive themselves within this country. The very dissatisfaction or even disappointment, which is very often seen and unfortunate trends for this country as immigration. And immigration being, well, a popular thing to do. In many regards, people are not immigrating only because of economic reasons. There are many, in most cases, immigrating also because of political reasons. Anyhow, this is also why I'm starting with these sad notes, is the reason that in this book we basically, at one point we realized that one of the major challenges for this country and for the Baltic states, all three Baltic states, are actually the very image of the country. And it's not only the external image, it's also the internal image. And what are the things which are hurdling this economic diplomacy? What are the things which are... which should be addressed in the first place. So, first of all, as I said, central agents and actors, those were the issues we were concentrating on during this book. And the Baltic states are relative newcomers to the global economic system, but they have learned the tricks and the trades. They're not always using them, at least they know them. They don't always have the resource, especially the human resources or even experience to do that. But in this case, at least they realize how the system is functioning and is potentially capable of using it. The same again about the very question: what is economic diplomacy? And that the diplomacy or diplomatic services in many countries, including this one, recently have acquired some new status just because of the liberalization or because of the globalization. And so in this case, support for economic activity is becoming one of the fundamental issues, or returning as one of the fundamental issues for any diplomatic service in the world. The same again, the question is, how do the diplomatic services contribute to the economic diplomacy and promotion of economic interests of the countries? So first of all, it's lobbying, it's promoting domestic goods and services, attempting to influence trade negotiations, partner countries and companies, and shaping regulatory activities, legislation. Those are the issues which are the mostly engaged into. So in this case, it's always that was the most challenging moment for us to define how to define what is economic diplomacy. And in this case, totality of instruments available used by government institutions and businesses in fostering economic security and economic benefits That's how we were understanding economic diplomacy in this book. We have multiple authors, of course, contributing from different countries. As there, I have seen a couple of authors again in the audience. So, if they want to contribute with something specific, and more in detail, of course, you're more than welcome. We would be very happy if you could. But therefore, I'm going to be very concise on what are the main points that the authors were making during their writings and during their research. So first of all, of course, the first chapter is concerning Latvia's, what is the state of play of Latvia's economic diplomacy, what are the legal and institutional frameworks. Well, there are basically two things which should be mentioned. Gats Pelnāts and Andris Čigadājevs there have written an excellent article. One thing is discussing what is the economic diplomacy. The second thing is concerning the fact that in mid 2014, external economic policy or responsibility for external economic policy returned back to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Latvia. So in this case, that's a major game changer. Just because, of course, this always the question is about the potential turf wars, and in this regard, this symbolizes that economic activity is not and will not be separated from the political positioning on issues. And second thing, of course, is about the businesses which are seeking additional administrative support. Not only the establishment of new embassies, this is one of the issues which the businesses have been pushing forward to. Andris Jakobsons addresses the trade and experiences of the of Latvia within the last several years, and again his main argument is about shifting more economic diplomacy towards businesses and away from public authorities and concentrating on discovering new markets and new opportunities. This is one of the essential things which actually the authors disagreed with each other on many. One of these issues on which the authors disagreed with each other. Gatis Pelnāts, he's writing on the what is the investment attractiveness of the country. His main conclusions, and this is where I come to my introductory part, is that the attractiveness of this country, and this is from the outside and to the outside and from the inside to the inside, is that insufficiencies and inefficiencies in crucial sectors. This is what is hurdling Latvia's economic diplomacy the most. It's about the court system, educational system, vocational training, corruption, low productivity as the main deterring factors for investors to be coming in. Artur Caune wrote a chapter on the issues of transportation and how the transportation sector is functioning in all this, and of course he mentioned many of notable improvements, but of course the greatest weaknesses still remain the quality of the infrastructure and logistics service, and he's basically emphasizing that the need for alternatives is absolutely necessary, and so in this case the Baltic state should enter a division of labor within the European Union, because they are seen as a single region and they must be building and rebuilding the logistics sector and industries as one single sector. Arvils Zeltiņš was writing, and I saw Arvils here, and he's going to probably add something, comment on the issues, although he's nodding or not. So that his argument is that the eastern direction is less profitable than the western one, but at the same time there's more potential. So this is what is mostly the appealing factor, that going to the east could be a gold mine, but it's of course a risky one. In case of the western dimension, Aldis Austers is very critical on many issues, and he's of course stating that the western dimension is absolutely institutionally and economically inseparable from countries' internal economics, because of course we are part of the European Union. And so at the same time he's criticizing that there's a need to meet the expectations with real economic improvements. This is what society, and this is what I was saying already in the beginning, that this is what society is expecting. They want to see some practical added value and improvements in their lives. He's criticizing about the vagueness of the economic diplomacy and this approach that Latvia is now willing to be represented in every region in the world, but at the same time he's saying that the resources should be devoted not to those exotic places, and I'm quoting him, exotic places, but to the Western European markets. Viljar, you're going to have your say on this, so probably I'm not going to go into your chapter, but finally, Ringaila Kokštita and Vytautas Kokštis, two Lithuanian colleagues of ours, they wrote on the issues which the Lithuanians are very worried about, and so in this case it's about the main conclusions that this sound domestic business environment, the same problem that I was saying was in the Latvian case, and necessity to improve the image of the country. And these are the similarities between all the three Baltic states. There are some minor differences, but there are so many similarities. And the major similarities is that, again, improvement of the country's image. And this is our proposal that maybe to a large extent the Baltic states should forget about trying to build an image only for themselves, for each separately, but they should be promoting themselves as a region. Moreover, this is the Baltic region, this is the Baltic Sea region, so we could be promoting ourselves as part of the Northern Europe, Nordic Baltic region. We could be promoting ourselves part of the Eurozone and part of the European Union, and in many other regards. So in this case, maybe this pooling of and sharing of resources is one of the things that we should be dealing with. I had a couple of comments on the presidency, but as time is running out, I'm not going to say that. Thank you.
Thank you, Kārlis. Yes, thank you for the quite thorough moving through the chapters and the whole publication. And I still hope that there is still some room for people to get some additional ideas and additional information also after reading the book as well. So, of course, we still encourage to read the book. But let's proceed to another, I can say another dimension. Of course, it's our neighbors, and it's one of the important events during the EU presidency or council of the EU council. Of course, will be the Eastern Partnership Summit. So, Diāna, Eastern Partnership, so how it looks like, so what is this Eastern vector, and how successful we might be there, and what are the challenges and opportunities in this direction, please. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, Andris. Okay, so although I'm also an editor of one of the books, here I focus on the Eastern Partnership due to the huge demand in this issue, and actually it has been a priority of Latvia already since 2013 for the presidency. And through all the 2014, I have not only seen how we are working towards the Eastern Partnership, but also have felt it very personally, because I'm starting one project on the partnership before the previous one ends. Yeah, so here goes another chapter. I will describe just very briefly what has been Latvia's policy in multilateral context within the EU internationally and also bilateral with the six Eastern Partnership states. And then I also proceed to our, as Andris requested, to our priorities for the presidency and to the challenges. So in the year 2014, we have been very active within the European Union discussing, although Latvia also is careful to remind that we pay equal attention to the Eastern Partnership and to the Southern Mediterranean. Still, the Eastern Partnership, of course, logically remains the major topic for us. We have discussed the issue, I guess, with all EU member states, all 27 partners, even the ones who are less interested, like Denmark or Spain. We have initiated several meetings, and also what is interesting, we have discussed the partnership also with our other partners. During the Brussels Forum last March, the foreign minister came forward with suggestion of a Euro-Atlanticism partnership, engaging the United States more closely into the region. And although this might seem as a one-off solution, which was suggested during the escalation of the Ukrainian crisis, this idea actually has not been forgotten, because also in November we have seen reappearing news on possible cooperation with the United States, so we just have to look how it proceeds. We have even discussed the Eastern Partnership with Japan, which might sound quite surprising. Like, what would Japan have to do with the region? Actually, Japan has been very active in the Ukrainian crisis. Yeah, and so Latvia has also had bilateral consultations with Japan on this issue. At the same time, for Latvia, Eastern Partnership is not only a priority within the European Union, and this policy has not been purely Europeanized, which means that we also mind our own interests in bilateral relations with the six countries, which are, just to remind, Armenia, Azerbaijan, Belarus, Georgia, Moldova, and Ukraine. For Latvia, in the last year, we have paid more attention to Ukraine, which is for obvious reasons, but not only in the security realm, but also in the realms of education, economic cooperation, assisting with the permutation of the association agreement, et cetera, et cetera. Then our next priority was, among the six states, maybe a little bit surprisingly, was Belarus, which is not an East Partnership frontrunner, but it is our neighboring country. And here, although we say that the dialogue should be dependent on the progress and reforms in this country, we still have been, I would say, very optimistic about the progress of reforms in this country. And there has been quite a lot of dialogue, including a meeting with the Foreign Minister McKay, who came here in February for 2 days. The next priorities would be Georgia, Moldova. And then with Armenia and Azerbaijan, we have been a little bit less active, but nevertheless, we stepped up the relations, and especially the last months of the last year have seen unprecedented amount of visits. So this would be for the last year, active movement forward. If we speak about priorities for the Latvian presidency, then as we know, Latvia purports to review the Eastern Partnership to give it a new impetus. And to revive the initiative, like increasing the offer to all six states. What is a little bit maybe less known here is that it's not only a priority of Latvia, it's a priority of the whole European Commission. So the European Commission is now starting to speak about the partnership review. And so there are several priorities which are common for the Commission and for the upcoming Latvian presidency, which is a good sign. It is to better tailor the EU's needs to each partner, to make the European Union's policy more flexible, which means that we not only offer association agreements to the states who have good progress with reforms, but we also give other offers, maybe alternative agreements to such states as Armenia, who are not interested in association agreement just yet. Another joint priority would be to strengthen economic cooperation with these countries, which is absolutely interesting for Latvia as well. And then it would be also to review the current implementation of the agreement, including association agreements, the CFTAs, which means that we also assist the states in implementing the decisions. Plus, Latvia has some own priorities, like transportation, like mass media. We have to know how far we actually go with the mass media. It is education, it is cooperation, the level of municipalities. So on the one hand, Latvia's policy is maybe not very ambitious. It doesn't sound very ambitious. We do not transform Eastern Partnership radically. If we speak about updates or upgrades, then it's mostly an upgrade. We just see what we have been looking before, doing before, and we try to do it better in the same direction. At the same time, I guess that Latvia has caught very well these current needs of the partnership, which is offers to all states, also those who are not interested in integration, but only in cooperation. Latvia is also speaking more about frozen conflicts and open conflicts in the neighborhood. And Latvia is working on more exact sectoral priorities which we could actually implement in relations with these neighbors. I view these priorities of the Latvian presidency quite optimistically because they are realistic and indeed they catch the mood, they correspond to what the Eastern Partnership states themselves have been saying. Okay, but now if we proceed just for briefly to some challenges in implementing this initiative, then we have some domestic challenges, we have some international challenges. International, of course, Russia is the major factor. And if in 2014 Latvia has been very active in calling for sanctions against Ukraine and we still support against Russia, and we still support the sanctions against Russia, then now we also see this greater focus on dialogue with Russia, and we have to look how exactly we proceed with this dialogue, which is, of course, if Russia changes its policy, our policy could also be changed in response, but then we must be very careful in assessing exactly what changes take place, not to slide back into closing our eyes on the certain confrontations in the neighborhood. Internal expectations are how much we can actually achieve, and this has been discussed in Latvian media also recently, criticizing Latvia for lack of foreign policy ambition. And here we must indeed, again, also strike the balance, which is, on the one hand, Latvia is the presidency of the European Council. On the other hand, indeed, Latvia is not the main agenda setter here, and we must cooperate very closely with the Union High Representative. So again, here it is just one of the challenges, how exactly we strike the balance between our own needs and the needs of the European Union, even if they are main corresponding. So there is a difference between being realistic and ambitious and being overambitious. Of course, other differences are in actually elaborating this offer. And here also I would speak about cooperation with the think tanks and using our academic resources in figuring out what exactly in which fields we can offer to each Eastern Partnership state. Okay, but I guess my time has run out, so I just give the floor back to the moderator.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Diāna. Viljar, I will not give you floor now, excuse me. I'll give the floor to Jānis Kažociņš, because I think that you will sort of look in a Baltic perspective, and that's why I think we finish with a Latvian perspective, and then we move into the wider perspective, how it looks like. So Jānis Kažociņš, advisor to the Ministry of Defense, Ministry of Foreign Affairs, with a very good knowledge on what's going on in security field. So please, what's your perception, how the 2014 looked like and what we should do in 2015?
Well, thank you very much. I see this has a red light, which means the microphone will pack up any moment. I've only been asked to speak for a short time, and the article which I wrote for the yearbook is entitled, Will Latvia Be Putin's Next Visit Victim in 2015? I can tell you straight away the answer is probably no. However, it is important that we should look at the various challenges that are presented, including the security challenges, and look at ways that we can alleviate them. And of course, the one which has come to the fore in the last few days or a couple of weeks is terrorism. The events in France, in Paris, are of course shocking, but let us not get it out of perspective. Europe has been experiencing terrorism since the end of the Second World War in one form or another, sometimes in extremely acute forms. So for instance, if I give you an example, the total number of British military deaths during the Northern Ireland so-called Troubles are about two times as many as in the Bosnian or Balkan conflict, Iraq and Afghanistan altogether. And that is in a stable democracy with no bordering country which is actively supporting terrorism, and yet you see what the results can be. That means, of course, that a great deal has to be done to face terrorism. At the same time, coming from the intelligence, from an intelligence background, I know that a great deal is already being done, and it is important that politicians, in trying to show that they are making sure that the services are working better, do not damage that cooperation which is already happening by trying to improve it, because that cooperation can only work on the basis of absolute trust, because intelligence on terrorism very frequently is based on human intelligence as well, and that is very sensitive, in particular to individuals whose lives frequently depend on it. Moving on to more, as it were, conventional things. In the article, I look at a number of possible threats to Latvia, and I start with nuclear, and I'll say a couple of words on that. President Putin does like to rattle the nuclear saber. And, of course, people who look at this from outside are justifiably worried. But just think for a moment that if in the circumstances of the exercise Zarpa 2009, which ended with a mock Russian nuclear strike against Warsaw, if that were to take place, that would place the United States in the position of only having two courses of action. One is not to respond and to give up Europe to Russia completely, and to see its foreign policy disintegrate worldwide. And the other is to respond. And when I asked, well, what if the president of the time doesn't have the courage or the determination or doesn't see it that way to respond, then a very prominent think tanker who's well known to many of us here, but whose name I won't mention, who is very much of a democratic and liberal disposition, said he'd be impeached the next day. As far as a conventional attack against the Baltic states, that certainly was possible before Ukraine. As things stand at the moment, I think General Ben Hodges, who's coincidentally visiting Latvia at this moment, who is the commander of the US Army in Europe, said a couple of days ago that at the moment Russia does not have the military power to be able to take on a second target such as the Baltic states while the Ukraine crisis is continuing. But that will change if Russian defense plans continue. And that means in the foreseeable future, in a 3 to 5 year scenario, that could become a much more serious threat, and that's why it's such a good thing that we're working together against it. Insurgency is another problem, and I think it is important to note that that is the way that the Ukraine crisis has been developing over the last couple of months, with bombings. In fact, the bombing of last night in the courthouse in Kharkiv led to a number of injuries. And that is something which is extremely worrying and something we should be taking into account. Low-level political, economic, and military pressure has already been mentioned. And I think the economic pressure is extremely important, because if we look again at Ukraine, it is arguable that Ukraine's biggest threat is from its inability to deal with corruption rather than the threat to the Donbass. It is something which ordinary Ukrainians, particularly those who were very much in support of Euromaidan, feel very unhappy about, and the new parliament has not actually solved this problem yet. It is something that we need to look at ourselves, because in Latvia, our anti-corruption bureau is not working as well as it should. Looking a little bit further, we also need to think about the information war. Whether we like it or not, have been caught up in an information war with the Russian Federation. And when I say we, it is not just Latvia, not just the Baltic states, but we in the Baltic states in particular, because of our specific circumstances, notably our large Russian minority, Russian-speaking minority, but the West in general. And the West does not really know how to deal with this. And that is a problem which is being tackled now at a very senior level. We see a number of initiatives, but large-scale, very expensive initiatives are less likely to be effective than small-scale ones aimed at bolstering the systems that we have at the moment for giving objective information to our own citizens and possibly over the border as well. And, of course, we have to take into account whether we are prepared to accept censorship of any kind. Personally, I'm absolutely against it. And whether we go in for some kind of counter-propaganda, which, again, I think is the way to lose this particular battle. Before I wind up, what I'd like to say is a couple of things about what we need to do ourselves. Of course, NATO deterrence and NATO presence in the Baltic states is very important, and that is coming along. Self-defense capability and showing that the costs of invading the Baltic states would be very high, that is also something which is being developed. But I think social integration based on common interests, a theme we've already heard, is extremely important. And the constitutional assumption of power, what I laughingly, well, I didn't, I quoted a Latvian journalist who laughingly referred to the little green president. Well, if you look at surveys, the two front runners, if people are given open choice as to who should be the overall elected president, is Lembergs, the mayor of Ventspils, who has for the last 4 years been undergoing very serious criminal charges, and Neil Sushkovs, a extremely popular and successful mayor of Riga, but of course from the party Harmony, which has a direct agreement with Putin's party, Yedina Rossiya, United Russia, and with the Chinese Communist Party. So there are certain risks, though as a committed Democrat, I also see the advantages. As far as Ukraine is concerned, I think it is worth noting that during the period of Christmas and the New Year, those who watch and listen to Russian media will have noticed that there was a tremendous reduction in the amount of propaganda which was going out about Ukraine, which is very strange because all year this has been something which had been hyped up. And now suddenly we see that there are major battles going on over Donetsk airport, and Mariupol is certainly under threat. Now, these are things which perhaps seem to be working in different directions, but what I found particularly interesting is the comments made by an ex-prime minister, Yevgeny Primakov, last week. And remember also that Primakov is also connected to the intelligence services, and that he is seen as an elder statesman, not somebody who could conceivably be a potential future presidential candidate, but somebody who is much respected, even it is heard by President Putin himself. And the things he said were that Russia should, amongst others, Russia should recognize Donbass as part of the Ukraine, that cooperation with NATO and the United States is possible, that a decentralized political system is required, or further decentralization, that economic diversification is something which Russia needs, and most amazingly of all, that Russia does not have a current threat from colored revolutions, which is directly against what the president himself has been saying and what the Kremlin official line is. And not only did he say these things, but they were published in Rossiyskaya Gazeta, which is not exactly a Kremlin mouthpiece, but certainly one which does not lightly publish comments which are directly against the Kremlin line. Now, that is all very important and very interesting. What it means, we do not yet know, but it may well be that there are some in the power vertical very near the top which are who are starting to feel that the direction which Russia has taken over the last year is not to their personal benefit, nor indeed to their national benefit. Winding up, I will just finish with what Peter Pomerantsev has said. He's produced a couple of very interesting pieces recently, but he was saying that Russia and Russian media is like a reality show, and the reality show is something which is artificially produced, and you need an artificial enemy. And suddenly, a year ago, there was a real enemy, and Russia found itself going from a reality show into reality. And heaven help us if this reality takes Russia, without intending to, into a much broader a military conflict. Thank you.
Thank you, Jānis. These were not short remarks, but I think very interesting and very valuable. So we have time for questions, no time for Viljar. Now, of course, we have time for Viljar, and I think it would be good to still to put in a wider perspective. So Viljar, what's about the Baltic countries? Because Kārlis mentioned we should have a common branding, the Baltic countries. Perhaps actually those positive paradoxes in a fragile and insecure environment also is that 2014, we've seen more the solidarity among the Baltics, again, the realization that fundamental things are common for us. Would you see like this? Or would you say that actually still competition is strong, that who goes to Davos, who reaps the economic benefits, who has the transit flows, who is more active? So what's your impression, 2014 and 2015? Is it about year of convergence of the Balticness and Baltic stances, or actually it's continuous divergence and different emphases, and it's sort of temporarily convergence of fundamental things? Willard, please.
Thank you. Does it work? Okay. Yes. Thank you. First, I would like to thank you for inviting me and offering me the publication possibility, because I tend to be sometimes too critical and they don't publish me anymore in Estonia. So usually when I'm writing about Estonia, they publish me only in Latvia. But I hope you can benefit from that, because many things what have happened with Estonia, they just happened with Latvia 1 year later. And you take the old volume of publication and you can find something useful maybe. This is the Estonian way to have a Baltic jokes. Because we are a little bit now in a new situation, as Andris pointed, that we don't feel anymore that comfortable that we are better than the other ones. Actually, we even don't want to talk about it anymore, because we see the statistics where Lithuania is in some strange way leading, and we hope the euro will do its effect and they will slow down. And we hope also that the military cost will slow down the Latvian economy. So we also somehow will gather together again. About the Baltic cooperation, this is one very important marker, what we can call that when the Baltic states start to cooperate, it means that the war is close. If you look before the Second World War, it's always has been that we fight almost to the last minute. But when there will be a cooperation between the military headquarters of Baltic states, then you actually time to take a boat ticket, not to cooperate anymore. So I hope this time we will succeed in a better way. Maybe some things what I would like to look about 2014 from the Estonian and also from the Baltic perspective is this, what you also touched, the big narrative question, what has been changing. First, what changed in Estonia, that our new prime minister, who is much younger than me, said that we don't need any narrative until the elections, and maybe also not after that. So we don't, we have interestingly agreed in society that there are no ideals. How did that happen? And that takes us back to this book, which started from Kārlis' letter to me about mercantilism and liberal trade values. Liberal trade has been like a central value for Estonians. Let's be unequal. We don't like to be equal. We like to be unequal, and we like to trade, and we like to point the finger to the weaker ones, and so on. And suddenly, now we have found out that Europe doesn't work that way, that there is no need for competitiveness. I made a survey among the students in Faculty of Economy, and only one student wanted to be an entrepreneur. The rest of them want to be an advisor in a city council. There is absolutely no need for the economic diplomacy in the future, it seems to me, that because the younger generation sees that redistribution is the value, not production. And in Estonian public sector, salaries are almost 20% higher than the average salary. So in these elections, for example, most of the good journalists go to run for the parliament. They give away their positions in the newspapers just to get the parliament seat. So this shows that we are a little bit back in somewhere where we didn't want to be in the 90s, that we are about solidarity, not sovereignty. We are about castle Europe with mercantilism, not liberal trade. And the younger generation is happy with that. And the older generation, if they try to explain that this is actually more economically rational, then they will be asked, who are your idols? And they say, of course, Ireland was our idol. Then Iceland was our idol. Then Slovenia. So what has happened? And then the younger generation says, look at France, look at Germany. You should do like them. So what we have seen, that we have lost the values in that sense, or we have lost the old values. Liberal trade is not anymore value. Even the territorial defense is not anymore the value. We rely more and more to the common defense. We even don't calculate in terms how we can survive ourselves, but we calculate how we can support American forces in Estonian soil. So, and this change has already happened, and now it's also what it means is that success is redefined. For the younger generation, success is if you get more subsidies from the EU, if you can help European Central Bank to create more debt, to borrow it, to decrease, if you can have more third sector employment, if you can be more solidarity, you can show more solidarity with France in Central Africa. And we see that if we look at the resource distribution, that if we like put the resources to the new places, then actually we get them from the units where we used to define national interests. So I also have this game with students that I ask them, what are the five main priorities of Estonian foreign policy? And it's a very sad story year after year. So now they even don't want to tell me who is the foreign minister. Not the most popular person in the country. So we have lost interest to the foreign policy almost at all. And the only interest what we have left is, of course, the defense policy. And here we must thank this crisis, which is not a nice one, but actually brings us back to the main questions. So what will we have for the next years? I think we have to admit some processes which are not very happy ones. First, the Swiss franc event, which shows that the global coalition has been lost in that topic. That somebody is jumping out first from the boat, and it might be the start of currency wars, and it might be not for the stability of euro. And it has not had its effects yet. So the second, about Ukraine and Putin, I think we are too much enjoying that Putin is in trouble. He is in trouble, but he has no normal exit, so he's like the rabbit in the corner. And definitely we don't want to be bitten by the rabbit in the corner. So I think Europe and us also, even if it feels very unpleasant, we have to find a way for him somehow not to bite us. In the moment, it seems that he has the choice only to bite us or be killed by the local Russian forces, or how to say. It will, for him, it's not too many choices. So I think this would be the foreign policy aim to give Putin some kind of exit. And also the Baltic cooperation, as the last one, we were said that we are doing Baltic cooperation, but I think we're still not using the Baltic resources for analysis. We are, the politicians gather together, shake hands and say that we have cooperation, but I don't see the central banks making joint calculations and the ministries making joint programs, talking about development cooperation. So I hope this will go more to the technical level where it really benefits. But in the moment, as I said in the beginning, that Estonia is still in that bad feeling that we lost the first place and we're almost in the third place. And it's interesting. We have to learn from Latvians. I was asked the colleagues to go here and find some warm Latvians to teach us about presidency. Can you imagine how unpleasant that it is? So the things have changed. Thank you.
Well, yeah, thank you. We are always happy to have you here in Latvia. So, and of course, we are always willing to cooperate. Even so, I think I would add to this, and this has been already for some time, my suggestion, but it doesn't come through, in comparison to Visegrad countries. And Visegrad countries have a Visegrad fund for exactly is supporting and promoting the cooperation among the universities, academics, and think tanks. And they don't have the politicians, you can say, so Visegrad assemblies. We have Baltic assemblies, but we don't have Baltic fund. So there we have a little bit different priorities, even though I believe it would be very important also to encourage more intense cooperation among the intellectual think tanks, academia, etc., etc. And that's why we're always happy to have you on the board and to contribute and to provide this wider Baltic perspective and sometimes say good things about Latvia as well. So we are happy to have you. I think the time is running out and it's been quite long. Somehow you see that we want to say so many things and sometimes they are a little bit contradicting and sometimes a little bit fragmentary and we didn't elaborate on everything in thoroughly and in depth. And I think there are so many issues to elaborate and I hope that you will be able to read those books as well. I think they are really good articles by authors who contributed. But we still have 15, 20 minutes before the coffee being served just next to us, so we can open the floor for Q&A for 15, 20 minutes, please. Some comments, suggestions, some your own visions, what are important things in 2015, what has been or has not been done in 2014, or some questions, of course. Please. Yes, I see some hand over there, even though I didn't. Please.
Okay, this is actually was a question for Mr. Bukovskis because you touched upon that. Igor Siplit is the creative director of Audiovisual Media Arts Department at Riga International School of Economics and Business Administration. There was an article in December issue, which was articles like that appear once in a while, and the article, the title was, "Why Should We Care About the Baltic States? If they don't care to defend themselves." And of course, we all agree that reaching the 2% of GDP for national defense at the year 2020, that's kind of a little bit too late. So if I'm US taxpayer and being a devil's advocate, my question would be, what would be the reason for the United States really to defend the Baltic states if they don't care to raise their defense spending ASAP starting this year. I mean, to wait until year 2020, that's kind of too long, especially in the face of the fact that Putin is planning to rearm the country completely by the year 2020. So if I am a US taxpayer, what would be your answer to what's the interest of the United States to defend when they don't want to defend themselves?
Mm-hmm. Okay, some other questions? Let's take immediately some round of questions and comments. Please. So? Yes, please.
Well, thank you for your answers. I have a question about public diplomacy, especially for you, Mr. Sprūds. Since you've mentioned that the economic diplomacy is very important for Baltic states, which is undoubtedly true, how well we achieved in 2014 in public diplomacy and what we should perceive in 2015? Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Okay, some other questions? Yep, over there.
Yeah, thank you for your answers. Well, I've got a question about constitution and preamble to Mr. Kārlis Bukovskis. Don't you think that this preamble divides our society more? So that's the question.
Mm-hmm. Preamble. So some other questions from that side perhaps as well. Okay, so let's Kārlis, I think that you had a couple of questions, but we can of course add that. I mean, if you ask.
How many minutes do I have?
20 minutes. Go ahead.
Good. Okay. So the first question on the why should the American taxpayer care about the Baltic states? Well, excellent question. Thank you. I have been wondering about this myself as well quite a lot. I think first of all, if I may address before answering the question, I want to state a couple of things. Is that I think the very fact that the budget wasn't increased immediately to 2% is largely related with the fact that there's still a hope. First of all, there's still a hope that the relationship with Russia will get better at one point. It's just so in this case, and this is the second point, that it's not to overreact, not to seem that we are overreacting in this regard, because of course keeping the balance inside the country, not stirring up unnecessary emotions or even panic inside the society. Those are the issues which have been among the things that have been thought about. But why should the Americans care about the Baltic states and about Latvia in this regard? I think the most important thing is the symbolic value. As strange as it sounds, as vague as it sounds, but the very symbolic value that the Baltic states were there, where the Eastern European, other Eastern European countries or Eastern Partnership countries are still in. We were 20 years ago, we did it, we made it, we introduced democracy, we respect human rights, we have open market economies. This is a question that if you forsake this part of the region, or this part of the world, then in that case the question is, where do you stop? This is salami tactics. Where do you stop if you give up Baltic states, who are full democracies, who are part of the European Union, part of NATO, and if you think that they are not worth defending, then the question is, which country is then the worth defending? Is it Germany? Is it France? Maybe only Britain. So in this case, it's always about the very more of the symbolic value and more of the very fact that the Baltic states have always projected themselves as friendly towards the United States and towards the Western values. The second question about the preamble, this is a good question. It's just in this case, I don't think that preamble in the very form as it is, and there are multiple issues which I do not like that they're mentioned in the preamble, and I would have changed a couple of things to something else. But I don't think that emphasizing national narrative or the very fact that this country exists in order to protect the Latvian language and culture is the thing which should be avoided, and I don't think that it
immediately creates tensions because it doesn't antagonize anything. It actually even includes the wording respect for minorities, which the original constitution, so to speak, didn't include. So in this case, the very fact that the very understanding and the very admission that the minorities exist in this country and they need to be respected in the very preamble of the constitution is essential achievement in my understanding. And I don't think that we should be looking at this sentencing that is put in the constitution necessarily as something as a new dividing lines or anything. I would actually say that this is more uniting than the previous version that was. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Kažociņš?
Just a couple of points on the 2%. Of course, if you are a United States congressman, then it is extremely difficult to explain why your taxpayers have to pay 4.5%, nearly 4.5% GDP, while the Latvians and Lithuanians can't even manage 1%. Yes, but of course, that is all part of being the superpower at the moment. And being part of that is, of course, being able to maintain the links with those who support you. And I think the Baltic states have been consistent supporters of United States foreign policy since renewed independence. And though our contribution is very small, it is nonetheless important. But can I turn it around in the other direction? And that is why 2% in this financial year would make absolutely no sense. First of all, it would be very, very wasteful of resources. Defense spending takes proper planning, and most of the things which really are going to work well cannot be done on the spur of the moment. That's one side of it. The other side of it is that if we look at the challenges that we face, we've already heard this today in the discussion several times, that social integration is as important to us here as our defense and our membership of NATO. If we get that wrong, all the rest of it will count for very little. Of course, we will have friends coming to our aid, but it is that which matters. And that means that a sensible, rational government has to take account of other requirements, particularly in health and education, because if we go down a budgetary track which gives too much emphasis on defense and security, then we run the risk that at the next election we will get a populist government which may completely reverse that altogether and lead us into a much less secure situation.
Yes, please. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Because defense is something that is different. We already spend more than 2%, and I think the correct for the next year will be even 2.2 in Estonia, as we are allocated some special funds also for hosting American forces. But how to explain it to American congressmen or French congressmen, which is even more interesting for us, or German, I think, what is most important, is that we have failed with communication. I make an example. During the financial crisis, Estonia supported directly with 250 million euros, this EFSF and ESM. And we also gave guarantees about 3 billion euros. So what is 3 billion euros? We could buy the both Mistrals and we will still have half of the money left. Can you imagine? We just gave that guarantees just without, almost without debate in society. We also gave this 250 millions almost without debate. That would be more than enough to buy 100 German Leopard tanks from Dutch government, what did Finland. So if you ask where was the mistake, that we didn't communicate it. We made the effort, we showed solidarity, but if the congressmen don't recognize it, it's our fault that we didn't make it, how to say, didn't publish it enough. Because we have spent a lot of money and believing that being in Central African Republic, in Afghanistan, in Iraq, makes it understandable for congressmen. But now it's time for us to learn, and I think here is where we have been spending more than Latvia and Lithuania, and you can learn in advance how to spend visibly. Thanks. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, and I think I had also the question on public diplomacy. I think it is very important. It's a very important question because, well, it is about the image of the country, image of the nation, image of society. It's about, in a sense, a brand, and we've been searching for what is Latvian brand for years, and Latvian Institute has been working on this for years, and it seems not very always successfully. But I think it's much deeper than just to elaborate some kind of brand. It's about how you are being perceived. Are you successful? Are you attractive for investments? Are you attractive for trade? Are you attractive as a model which is worth following as well? Are you equal as society which has established equality and just system within society? I think these are very important elements, and basically there is this interconnection in a sense within public diplomacy, which is about instrumentality, but not only. And of course, if we speak more in narrow terms about public diplomacy this year, I think that 2015, our presidency in the European Council, European Union Council, will be the most important public diplomacy exercise in a sense. Outside showing our capacities, our ability to mobilize, but actually also public diplomacy within the country, showing that Latvian society also takes responsibility for some things, that it's not just decisions are being made within Brussels, but also decisions actually are being made also Riga, and it's important to sort of to have this feeling and understanding, so the public diplomacy actually goes in a sense both ways. You can add to this a more instrumental way as well, how we communicate in insecure environment, strategic communication center has been established last year, and again the paradox is that events in 2014 actually added life and added value to the center here in Riga, because especially we have to deal in the neighborhood, and I think that we have the chance to also to show our expertise in this regard. But at the very end, you cannot create, once more, you can say the public diplomacy success story artificially. It is basically everyday life and everyday activities and everyday homeworks which should be done. And we come back to all issues also what Jānis was mentioning on corruption and fighting corruption and equal society and consolidation of society, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So that's why public diplomacy at the very end depends how solid you are, you can say, domestically. And then, of course, you can build more successful instruments in terms of external projection of your successes. Okay, some other ones. Ion, you've been also writing an article. Please.
Morning. Rich Martin Hempel, Baltic Times. Just a very quick question on, speaking of public diplomacy, on what the panel's thoughts are as to whether Andris Sprūds should attend the Victory Day parade in Moscow?
I have a very quick and simple answer. No. I believe that he should not attend. And of course, we might speak, and I once more underline the importance of dialogue and importance of keeping different formats open. And that's why I really appreciate and I highly value the Mr. Inkevich going to Kiev and going to Moscow and going to Brussels and expressing our opinions and not sort of showing that we are always troublemaker and we are always insecure. We should be more proactive, we should be self-confident of ourselves. And that's why I think this is a profession and duty and responsibility of diplomat to talk even in difficult circumstances. And that's why I highly appreciate Mr. Inkevich going to Riga. But about Mr. President going to Moscow, no. First of all, it's contradictory, always being perceived, and we remember that Vairavita Freiberga was in 2005 alone. In 2010 was Valdis Zatlers, not alone, but with Ilves then, but not again with Lithuanians. 2015, Baltic other presidents have announced they are not going, and I think actually they are right. They are right because, well, what has changed since 2014? Still Russia is very assertive. Still, Crimea has been annexed, and not even sort of putting aside, let's say, contradictory interpretations of the history. I think it's too early to show the, in a sense, sort of symbolic engagement. I think there should be sticks and carrots, and it's also underlined by people who sort of want to have more stability in the region. Yes, we have to have carrots. We have to show that if you behave well, I mean, we also are ready to behave well and we are ready to engage, but same time to participate in a victory parade, which will be sort of the once more exercise of the Russia's great powerness and sort of ambitions in the region. I believe this would be the wrong. And once more, I think we can also underline, I think Russia respects those countries which respect themselves. And I believe this is also respecting themselves at this particular event and those particular circumstances, keeping distance. Even though, at the same time, I believe the dialogue is important, but not parade of sort of victory day on 9th of May. So very clear, at least from my side. Yes, probably some other remarks.
Okay, I'm going to be devil's advocate. okay, let's try imagining that yes, he should be going, and I think again I'm looking at the public image, and I'm looking only from this point of view. I agree on most of the diplomatic issues which Andris mentioned. At the same time, this issue will always be controversial. Going, not going, whatever the choice is, it's going to be. Some people will not like it. Some people will like it. So in this case, if Andris is saying that he should not be going, I will be saying that he should be going, and the reason why is very simple. Because it's still, of course, this is showing off of Russia's military might and everything else, but at the same time, it also, the very idea behind this event is a celebration of the ending of the Nazi regime. So in this case, from the point of view of Latvia's public image and the very fact that we're a presidency country and that quite a lot of things and quite a lot of propaganda has been attributed to denouncing Latvia's position on many issues and in trying to project again Latvia as a Nazi supporting country or something like that. This is the moment when going participating and saying that yeah, well, we agree, Nazis, it's good that the Nazi regime didn't win. Well, that's my remark on this.
I cannot resist, and of course I don't want to engage here with Kārlis, I mean we'll still have time to engage, but I think just one remark. I think that's what I hear at least in public debate, and which for me is sort of interesting, that it's always somehow underlined that the EU presidency is crucial here, that we should follow what the EU presidency is. So I think that the EU presidency is secondary here. It's first of all national decision. Yes, we are taking responsibilities once more, engaging and being the foreign minister is representing the foreign policy of the EU to a large extent on some occasions. But this is about symbolism, this is symbolic events. This is actually the decision which is made on national level and also on regional level. And if we speak about solidarity among the EU countries, first of all, I still, perhaps naively, but I would like to come back to the Baltic solidarity. And I think on this symbolic event, we should be quite in the same boat. But Viljar?
Yes, I was thinking, as we have having a celebrity death match with the Finnish Minister of Foreign Affairs, so maybe we should send ministers of foreign affairs. They all very different and interesting, but I think Russians will not accept them. But for me, it would be really interesting to see Latvian Minister of Foreign Affairs and Estonian and also Finnish Tuomioja there representing completely another vision. And this was actually where I wanted to come, is that this question is very hard to solve in that sense that Finland is already showing some direction or trying to find some different direction. And you may not feel it that much in Latvia because we are in between you and Finland, but we really feel that we used to think that our southern border is like more appetite for Putin, but now it seems like Finland is more soft mentally, not militarily. And many people are looking like this, what they call Finlandization again. And the Tuomioja's comments have been making us look even more security guarantees. Because we have been relying, even if Finland is not in NATO, but we have been relying their decisiveness. And now we don't see this decisiveness. And I think this parade will be interesting, especially from how the Nordic countries will be represented. Thanks.
Absolutely. Okay. So I think we should on this very interesting note, and you can see that we are starting the debate, and that's at the right time to stop the discussion and continue in at the coffee, and we can absolutely continue and express our arguments. And I think this is a quite a symbolic and controversial issue, and very important because I think it reflects those difficult choices. And also in 2015, when we will have opportunities to engage, but also challenges, and also sort of the showing the decisiveness, sometimes not to engage and show our position as well on our values and our, you can say, symbolic stances. With this, I am once more thanking my colleagues, panelists. I am thanking all the authors without whom it would be impossible to put the publication together. But at the same time, I am very much thankful to the audience who came, raised questions, and I am very much hoping so that you will be also, before the good night sleep, reading the book as well. So thanks a lot, and everybody is invited for a coffee. Thank you.